Today, based on popular demand, we're talking about the trade war. This time though, China, how are you guys doing? I mean, we're not levying hundreds of billions of dollars of tariffs against you guys to put Walmart out of business. I'm assuming that all of this is going to have some sort of impact beyond just making the next round of iPhones inexplicably more overpriced than they already will be. Well, it might already be having an impact because China's Federal Reserve activity is going off the charts. And for those of you watching for the first time, we sometimes go a little Federal Reserve crazy. But an intelligent Federal Reserve is like a pilot, in that you can tell a lot about how things are going in the economy based on their activity. And some are worried that it looks like they've just put on the first strap of the parachute, because...
Reuters reports China's central bank Sunday announced a steep cut in the level of cash that banks must hold as reserves. The country is stepping up moves to lower financing costs and spur growth. This amid concerns over the economic drag from an escalating trade dispute with the United States. The reserve requirement cut is the fourth by the People's Bank of China this year.
To be clear, this act, combined with others we'll talk about in a bit, isn't direct evidence of an economic downturn. The official party line is everything is awesome. Still though, the fact that China has slashed the amount of cash some of its banks must hold in reserve is not a great sign, because it's a sign that Beijing's leadership is seeking to bolster a flagging economy. So before we go on, I need to talk about the philosophy of Federal Reserves. There's a dead-end liberal arts degree for ya. Guys, we need to stop for a second and ask, why in this universe of infinite depth are we really raising the key interest rate by a quarter of a percent? Your Eastern and Western Federal Reserves operate differently, which makes certain actions that Chinese and Japanese central banks engage in seem very odd to us. Take, for example, the reserve requirement ratio. In 2011, Reuters reported that forcing banks to lock up more cash is China's most viable policy option as it battles inflation. And that makes sense, because you want to lock up cash in bank vaults to make the Chinese cash floating around more valuable. Unfortunately, Western Federal Reserves can't really do that, because our banks are constantly trying to play limbo with the reserve requirements. If you have 1 cent above that reserve requirement, well, that's 1 cent that's not making you money. This means that if you raise reserve requirements, well, that immediately just triggers a huge sell-off and locks up cash as banks scramble to get the vault more money. The last time we raised reserve requirements was...
So what's inside Dodd-Frank, and how is it supposed to prevent something like the financial crisis from happening again? Well, it's a long and complex piece of legislation, we're talking hundreds of pages long, that brought about the most significant changes to financial regulation in the US since the reform that followed the Great Depression.
And that was 8 years ago. Wow, do I suddenly feel old. Instead, our Federal Reserve will just sell tons of securities that they possess so that they can soak up some of the cash. Anyways, China plays a little bit more fast and loose with their reserve rates, because their banks tend to have more cash just sitting around, so changing this isn't as dramatic as some might imagine. Still though, they're not reducing the reserve requirements because the banking lobby is so powerful in China. China is the banking lobby. Instead, the problem they're trying to solve is investment growth has slowed to a record low, and net exports have been a drag on growth in the first half of the year. Now, saying investment growth has slowed to a record low in China is like saying Trump is tweeting a record low crazy things. Don't worry, there are still quite a few gems for the news to focus on, but it's slowed to the point where I don't feel the need to invest in a bomb shelter every time I get a Twitter notification. Don't worry, Twitter, nobody in the world missed that one. Here's what I mean. It's reported that Chinese GDP growth slowed to 6.7% in the second quarter, while in the US it's jumped to a 4-year high of 4.1%. Oh no, 6.7%, what a victim you are. So here's a question for you. Two things are cited as causing the drop in growth. First, you have lagging in exports, which can be attributed to the trade war. But you also have a lag in investment, which is coming from a few things. First,
Here's the situation. China's borrowing soared to about 264% of GDP in 2016, all the way up from 163% in 2008. That outpaced the surge in the US and in the UK before the financial crisis. The problem could be bigger still because of the frantic rate of new lending, which makes it hard to know how many loans are not being repaid.
Wait, you're telling me China has a massive debt problem? I thought that was our thing. I'm not going to go into it in too much detail in this episode, but the more you study global debt economics, the more you realize it's just everyone passing around IOUs. China's debt issue is a bit different than what I normally talk about, though, because in their case, it's the state-owned banks taking money from the government and using it to finance infrastructure and growth projects. Now, some of you might be saying right now, Oh no! Maybe this is not a good time to be lowering reserve requirements. The trade war couldn't have come at a worse time for China, which is currently attempting to fix its state-owned bank debt situation. The analysts say,
something's not going right on the trade side. Meanwhile, back home, the really large issues for China are domestic debt. It's not the trade wars, it's their domestic situation. And we've got default rates showing up because they can't follow the US Fed up. They got to keep rates lower because they're on the cusp of defaults across the board.
So far, the trade war has only had a minor impact on China's vast $12 trillion economy. But the trade war complicates China's deeper problems with its onerous debt levels. So we're not quite kicking them when they're down, but we're definitely poking them pretty hard in a quite annoying way. Before this trade war, Beijing was just starting to coast on their growth and recoup some of those debts. But now they're back in stability mode. There's one other pretty big factor dragging investment, and I'm gonna play an earlier clip again, but focus on interest rates this time.
The really large issues for China are domestic debt. It's not the trade wars, it's their domestic situation. And we've got default rates showing up because they can't follow the US Fed up. They gotta keep rates lower.
Oh man, that's a bit of an issue. China's central bank left short-term rates unchanged on Thursday, choosing not to follow a benchmark interest rate rise by the United States Federal Reserve. Oddly enough, forget the trade war, Jerome Powell might be the lead general in this battle. These Fed rates tell quite the story. China's choice to maintain interest rates is believed to show China's economy is slowly losing momentum and is facing more pressure from escalating United States trade tariffs. While the American Fed, on the other hand, choosing to raise rates, sees the United States economy growing at a faster than expected pace this year, with only a slight slowdown in 2019. Woohoo! Of course, let me remind you, we are entering into speculation territory here. It's not quite, oh, he bought a Corvette, he must have a small penis. But it's close. So what is this rate? Well, it's the interest rate, and for the sake of this episode, every time you've heard about interest rates, it's pretty much this one. Raise this rate, and the interest you get on savings accounts and loans go up. And, well, that might be a problem for China because...
In absolute terms, China's total debt has ballooned from around $6 trillion at the time of the financial crisis to nearly $28 trillion by the end of last year.
And those loan rates might be a problem when the government is in debt because it gives the banks money to loan out for infrastructure projects. Now, it's important to note, we're talking about changes in interest rates. In absolute terms, China has a higher interest rate. But the constant lowering of rates isn't something you do when your economy is on fire, but rather when your economy is in flames. And in this case, you're trying to get money out of savings accounts and back into the market. Alright, going down in flames is a bit much, and honestly, looking at all of these reports, it doesn't seem like the trade war is a major influence on either the US or Chinese economy right now. It's making things more expensive for American consumers and limiting some of the Chinese growth. But it's going to have to escalate a lot more before we actually start to see any blood. It's mostly just exposing domestic Chinese problems that economists have been predicting will lead to China's collapse since before even Trump was president. Will this trade war destroy the Chinese economy? I know I'm forsaking quite a few clicks in saying this, but probably not. An agreement will be reached much before empires fall. All I can say is China is currently in stimulus mode, while the US is trying to tamper down our growth. Now you can find articles saying anyone's winning the trade war. America? Yep. China? Yep. Russia? Yeah. Heck, I bet there's even an article about how a heretofore unknown Papua New Guinean tribe is the biggest winner in all this. All I can say is that the biggest losers are the lower middle class Chinese who are losing jobs and the lower middle class Americans who are being priced out of items they would otherwise be able to buy. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking this floating logo to the right of my head. Or do it the old fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and remember to give me a thumbs up. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.